ناظرین فوری خبر آپ سے شیئر کریں. وزیراعظم عمران خان ڈیووس میں عالمی میڈیا کانفرنس سے خطاب کر رہے ہیں.
افغانستان which wants peace after 40 years of conflict is Pakistan, because we get directly affected by what happens in Afghanistan. The tribal areas which border Afghanistan have been devastated in this since after 9/11, the war on terror. It devastated those areas, and we feel that the only way we can rebuild those areas, we can give employment to the youth there, we can sort of rehabilitate their shopping malls and their houses, is if there is peace in Afghanistan and there's trade between the two countries. And of course Afghanistan is an economic corridor right up to Central Asia, so it's very important that there is peace there. And the only difference so far was that the US believed that there was some military solution, and I for one always opposed this military solution. I always believed that this whole war on terror was the wrong way of fighting terrorism. I felt that it created more terrorism because of collateral damage. We were witness to that in our own country, in Pakistan's tribal areas. The more drone attacks, the more people got killed, their families got killed in drone attacks, the more people joined the militants. So I was opposed to this, and for that I was considered anti-American. I was considered someone who was pro-Taliban. So finally the US policy under President Trump is that there should be peace talks, and there should be a dialogue, and there should be a political settlement. So we came on the same page, and that's why I have a good relationship with Pakistan has for the first time a decent relationship with the United States, because relationships are built on common objectives. Previously we had this awful situation where the US expected Pakistan to help them win the war in Afghanistan. Pakistan should never have accepted this challenge by the US, because we could not do it. We couldn't deliver. And so our governments made the big mistake of agreeing to the US what they couldn't deliver. As a result, we were reviled. We lost 70,000 people dead in this war on terror. And at the end, we were held responsible for the US not succeeding. Now, objectives were same. Both the United States, Pakistan, Afghanistan want peace. It was just a question of how to get the Taliban talking to the US and then to the Afghan government. So this was the main subject. Others were, of course, we want trade with the US. Pakistan wants help from the US in improving our trading relationship, which was previously was just a transactional relationship, Pakistan to help the US in the war on terror, and US gave us aid. Now we want a proper relationship with the US.
The last time you met, President Trump suggested he might be willing to get involved in Kashmir. You've called to internationalize the issue before. India, of course, has always opposed it. Is there any chance that's going to happen?
Let me just say one thing. You know, when my government came into power, I am a firm believer that, you know, military is not a solution to ending conflicts. In fact, you go into a conflict with one objective, and then it spawns various other unintended consequences, and other conflicts come out of it. So from day one, you know, I believed that the only way forward was we have peace, we try to have a peace settlement and help the US peace settlement with Afghanistan, mend our fences with Iran, because there were some border issues we had with them, which we did. And then the next was India. And India, you know, I have to say that I'm probably the one Pakistani who I feel knows India much better than anyone else. I have probably more friendships than anyone else in India. And because of cricket being such a big thing in India and Pakistan, and because of that cricketing background, I felt that I was ideally placed in improving our relationship between the two countries. So immediately I reached out to Prime Minister Narendra Modi, And I was amazed that there was, it was, the reaction was quite weird. Because, you know, we thought, you know, we said we, all our differences, which is mainly Kashmir, we could settle through dialogue. But, you know, the subcontinent hosts the greatest number of poor people in the world. And the best way to fight poverty is to have trading relationship between the two countries rather than spending that money on arms. So this is what I spoke to the Indian Prime Minister. But, you know, I came across a brick wall. And then really the events that happened, this suicide attack on in Pulwama in Indian side of Kashmir happened. Indian soldiers got killed. I immediately told him that if you can give us any actionable intelligence, we will act. But rather than act, they bombed us. So one of the Indian planes came down. We immediately returned the pilot, again saying that, you know, this is two nuclear-armed countries cannot afford a conflict. But really, it was after Mr. Modi won the second election, which was in 2018. And then when he annexed Kashmir, Kashmir, remember, is a disputed territory between Pakistan and India, according to the UN resolution 70 years ago, the 11 resolutions of the UN. And the people of Kashmir were supposed to decide their destiny through a referendum, a plebiscite. So India unilaterally annexed Kashmir, revoked their status, which was in their own constitution, this Article 370. And from then onwards, things went from bad to worse. And really, what is happening in India, let me just say one last word on that. Because, and I know India, I think it's a disaster for people of India. It's a bigger disaster for people of Kashmir, who for over 5 months now are literally in an open prison, kept there by 900,000 troops. It's a disaster for India because India is a multicultural society. It was the vision of Mahatma Gandhi and their first Prime Minister Jawaharlal Nehru, which was a secular society. And with this this philosophy, this ideology of Hindutva, which is the RSS philosophy, which was inspired by the Nazi when it came about in 1925, which believed in the Hindu racial superiority, and also was built on hatred against other races like Muslims, Christians. So therefore, I feel bad because, you know, how can in such a huge country with a Muslim population of 200 million people, there are Christians there, there are Sikhs there, there are Dalits there, there are tribals. I just think that the path which India is going is a disaster for India. But I feel that for people of Kashmir right now, it is the biggest disaster because they are trying to change the demography of Kashmir, which actually is against the Fourth Geneva Convention, calls it a war crime. So yes, I'm worried about Kashmir, and that's also what I talked to President Trump about.
So you said a lot there that I want to pick up on. First, to return to India and Pakistan and the idea of war. You almost went to war last year. You recently said that Pakistan will find it increasingly difficult to remain inactive along the line of control if India continues its attacks there. So how close to another major conflict are we? What can you do to prevent it, and what can the rest of the world do to prevent it?
Well, we're not close to the conflict right now, but I'm just looking ahead, and that's why it's important that, you know, the United Nations must act, the US must act, because what I fear is what happened in Pulwama. We asked India that, look, this suicide attack has happened, you blamed us, please give us any actionable intelligence and we'll react. But the dossier arrived after the Indian jets had bombed Pakistan. So my worry is, and by the way, after that, the whole election campaign, which Narendra Modi won hands down, was actually hatred against Pakistan and this whole jingoism and war hysteria. So my worry is that, you know, if things get bad in India, there are protests in India against these two citizenship law and registration law, these two laws they brought about. There are protests going on in India now. Worry is that, you know, to take attention away from if things get worse there, already there's a bombing along the line of control, things could get worse. And they might just try and distract from that. So you cannot have two nuclear armed countries even contemplating a conflict. That's why the US, the most powerful country in the world, and the United Nations, they must take steps. All I said was that why not send observers on along the line of control? Let the UN observers come and find out. India blames Pakistan, we are blaming India. Why not have observers there?
Mm-hmm. Trump, of course, also has a very close relationship now with Prime Minister Modi. Were you worried by Howdy Modi?
not by Howdy Modi. But this relationship is understandable because India is a huge market. And, of course, every country would like trading ties and benefits of this huge market. And that's fine. My only concern is not about the US-India relationship. My concern is that it's the direction India is going. And I'm worried about that. You know, if you've read history and you read what happened in Nazi Germany, the sequence of events, it's striking resemblance. Nazi Germany between 1930 and 1934 went from a liberal democracy to a fascist, totalitarian, racial state. If you look at what is happening in India in these BJP 5 years, look where it's heading. And that's the danger bit. You know, and you're talking about a huge country of 1.3 billion people and nuclear armed. So this is where the whole idea of United Nations was to prevent some sort of a conflict happening again. And this is a potential flashpoint, and that's why I think that President Trump and the UN should act.
So since we're at the World Economic Forum, let me ask a question about the economy. Pakistan's economy has crashed 13 times over the last 60 years and required an IMF bailout each time. Fitch, the credit rating agency, recently gave Pakistan a B rating, saying its economy is, quote, constrained by structural weaknesses reflected in weak development and social and governance indicators. The WEF's brand new social mobility index ranks Pakistan 79 below Sri Lanka, Bangladesh, and India. Pakistan is among the lowest investment rates in the world and last year imported twice as much as it exported. You came into office promising a new Pakistan. What kind of reforms are you making to break this cycle and fix the economy? And why should investors have any more confidence this time than in the past?
You see, the Pakistan in the 60s was one of the fastest growing countries in Asia. Pakistan was industrializing faster than anyone else. It was a model which was copied by a lot of countries. And Pakistan was ahead of all the countries in the subcontinent. So my contention is that it's not lack of resources that make a country poor. My contention is that it is corruption why countries become poor. And why corruption? Because corruption does, number one, it destroys institutions. You can't make money if I'm the prime minister, if I have to make money. I cannot make money unless I destroy the state institutions, which would be a check on me. So all the justice system, the accountability bureau, the tax collection system has to be destroyed for me to make money. And that's what happens. I mean, if you look around in the developing world, look at some of the poor countries, they are resource rich. And yet there's massive poverty. So number one, it destroys state institutions, which is the biggest, taking out money is just one issue. But in the process, the destruction of the institutions is really what damages a country. And secondly, it is, because you have to take the money out of the country, because otherwise it will be spotted. So therefore, in taking the money out, it then starts, this money laundering starts putting pressure on the currency. And so when the currency devalues, it leads to inflation, more poverty, and then the money that should be spent on human development, invariably, I can tell you our experience, went into these mega projects for mega kickbacks. So the resources are distorted. So that's what happened to Pakistan.
So from what are you doing to change that?
So mid-80s onwards, that was a watershed. And that's when the two families took over and we sort of started going down. What we have done now is, number one, that we are trying to strengthen the state institutions. We have conducted a big accountability drive, which has never happened in Pakistan before. Secondly, we have tightened up our laws on money laundering. But much more importantly, the basic direction of a country. Before then, we used to have these boom and bust because we had growth rate, which was artificial because it was through import-led growth. So import-led growth led for a while, and then, of course, we would end up into a crisis situation and then an IMF bailout because we had this huge current account deficit. This time, we have, since we've been there, we have cut down we inherited the biggest current account deficit. We've cut it down by 70%. We brought down our imports. We have our exports. We had to adjust the currency so that it became exports became compatible, could compete with the other countries. And for the first time, my exports, which were stagnant for 5 years, are now showing signs of improving. And our currency is stable. In fact, it's gained since we took these measures. Stock market, the markets are now, our stock market is the highest in a year. And our investment in just 1 year, year to year, it's gone up 200%. So our direction is right. Obviously, there's a lot of hard work to do, but I think we are headed in the right direction.
And how much can you do in the ways of reform on productivity, corruption, et cetera, when the military still has such vast business interests and is still so powerful?
I can say that, you know, this is probably the first government that is totally being supported by our military. There's no issue between the government, civilian government, and the military. And the reason is that I think there is a total trust there because this is the cleanest government. And the reason why the previous clashes used to take place was that when the civilian government, the leadership started making money, the military had these intelligence agencies which would know what was going on. So therefore, there was always this clash, not because of the military was interfering in the civil administration or in the government, but it was because the leadership always wanted to control the military because they were scared, they were vulnerable, because the military always knew the extent of corruption that was being done. We have complete support. My foreign policy, which I am following, is completely supported by all institutions, including the military, simply because they believe that we are in the right direction. So I have had no problems with the military ever since our government has come into power.
Last question for me, and then I'll open things up. You've been very vocal, as you were today, about criticizing India's treatment of its Muslims and the oppression.
وزیراعظم عمران خان بین الاقوامی میڈیا کونسل سے خطاب کر رہے ہیں. ڈیووس میں ان کا کہنا ہے کہ پاکستان وسط ایشیا کے لیے ایک اقتصادی راہداری بنتا ہے. پاکستان ہمیشہ افغانستان کی صورتحال سے متاثر ہوتا ہے. افغانستان میں امن ہوگا تو پورے خطے میں امن ہوگا, تجارت پھیلے گی, وسط ایشیا تک تجارت ممکن ہو سکے گی. اس کے علاوہ ان کا یہ کہنا تھا کہ دہشت گردی کے خلاف جنگ میں پاکستان کا بہت نقصان ہوا ہے, پاکستان کے سرحدی علاقے سب سے زیادہ متاثر ہوئے ہیں. وزیراعظم عمران خان کا گفتگو کرتے ہوئے یہ کہنا تھا کہ امریکہ ہمیشہ سے طاقت کے استعمال کی جو ہے وہ پر زور دیتا آیا ہے افغانستان کے مسئلے کے حل کے لیے, لیکن وزیراعظم کا کہنا تھا کہ میں نے ہمیشہ طاقت کے استعمال کی مخالفت کی اور اب امریکہ یہ بات سمجھ گیا ہے کہ افغانستان کا مسئلہ ہے یا کوئی بھی اور مسئلہ ہے, طاقت کے ساتھ اس کا کوئی حل نہیں نکل سکتا ہے. ان کا یہ کہنا تھا کہ پاکستان اور بھارت کے درمیان جو تعلقات ہیں وہ بہتر ہو سکتے ہیں.